Tarana Burke, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
For people who are unaware of your story, mm-hmm. where did the Me Too movement begin?
I was living and working in Selma, Alabama in the United States, and I ran a youth program, a youth leadership program for girls, for black and brown girls in our community. Mm-hmm. And those girls very often were sharing with me their experiences with sexual violence. And as a survivor of sexual violence myself, it felt like I needed to do something, and something more than just tell them it's going to be okay, or providing comfort. And when I tried to find resources in the community to help me, because I wasn't an expert, there just weren't any, and none that were really culturally competent. And so I started doing the work. I started out doing these workshops for the girls that were kind of piggybacking on the leadership development work. And it really grew from there because it was such a need.
You've spoken about your own experience with sexual violence, but mm-hmm. do you remember a moment in your life when you realized how pervasive and widespread the issue was?
Oh, yeah. You know, because of it's kind of how we saw Me Too go viral. We started a MySpace page in 2006, which is kind of how we mark the mm-hmm. start of using Me Too. But we started this MySpace page, and social media was very new at the time. And within days, so many people reached out to us saying, oh, thank you for starting this, and we really need this, and how can we join? Mm-hmm. And in my mind, this was always going to be something for youth, for young people. And when I realized these adults were reaching out to us, it also made me think, well, I'm an adult. And I could use this. I could have used this when I was a young person, but I could even use it now. And I realized we had sort of an epidemic. Like, there were just people coming from every walk of life who were saying Me Too.
And that was even in the earlier days it was a MySpace. So what did it feel like for you when you saw Me Too start to trend on Twitter and the movement just exploded online?
You know, I get asked this question a lot. And I think that the thing that surprised me more, I was not surprised by the number. I really wasn't, just because I know how far it is. I've never been in a room with, 20 people where at least 10 of them couldn't say Me Too. Mm-hmm. So I knew when you blow that up, then you have, the whole world is affected by it. What surprised me more was that there was an attention span for it. There really hadn't been an appetite from people to talk about sexual violence publicly, and not just from me, from other people in the field who've been doing this work for years. It's been very difficult to crack into the mainstream. So that part definitely surprised me.
And it has been the proliferation of the movement online mm-hmm. has been in many ways inextricably linked to the revelations about Harvey Weinstein. Mm-hmm. How has it been watching the trial for you?
It's interesting because so many people think that this trial, that the whole movement rests on this trial. And I know some of the survivors, some of the women who came forward about Harvey Weinstein I've gotten to know in the last 2 years. And I know for them it's been really difficult to watch this. And so I think of it through their eyes and how them thinking about, the stories that they came forward to tell being ripped apart and torn to shreds and having to retell over and over these nightmarish mm-hmm. things that happened. So, I watch it thinking, I hope for them that there's some catharsis in this, in mm-hmm. seeing the person who made your life miserable, who tried to ruin your life, really, at least have to be accountable for it. So, it's just been interesting to watch. It's been interesting to watch how people report on it as well.
Yeah, and I want to get to that. Mm-hmm. But what is your reaction to the controversial way that the lawyer has cross-examined in this trial? Because I've heard you speak about it before, it's very difficult for victims of sexual violence and harassment to keep retelling their stories mm-hmm. over and over again, especially when they're being subject to such scrutiny. So tell me what you feel about that.
I think some of the things that I've heard are vile, to be quite honest. Mm-hmm. I think that her, the comments that she's made in the public about, I've never been a victim of sexual violence because I wouldn't put myself in that position. She's really doubling down on stereotypes and really bad information that people have about the truth on sexual violence. And it does a disservice to the work that we do to shift the narrative, the mainstream narrative about what really happens in the life of a survivor.
What does society need to do so that people stand up and pay attention to when it's happening and it's not affecting famous people, names and faces that we recognize? Because I think particularly of women or men, who are vulnerable or powerless and don't have the money for legal fees and don't have the position to walk away from a job.
Yeah.
What about those people and how do we begin to support them?
Well, you know, the thing that's always so fascinating to me is that if you think about the lifespan of Me Too and how it started, yes, there were very famous people who came forward, but that really preceded the moment, the viral moment. The viral moment happened because of the people you're talking about, because everyday people got the courage to come forward and say this thing happened to them. And then we sort of pivoted away and we don't, the mainstream media at least pivoted away and we don't hear enough stories about those people anymore. So those of us who have power and positions of power, who have, you know, the means to amplify, have to do our job and our due diligence to make sure that those stories are put forward first. We have to tell a different story. We have to make sure that the narrative is not focused on this really, really narrow part of the spectrum of sexual violence, because there is really, we don't talk enough about what happens to children, right? There's been very little conversation about child sexual abuse in this moment, when really at the heart of what I was doing was around child sexual abuse. There's not enough talk about just any number of things, what happens to black and brown women and indigenous people. So, you know, queer people, trans people, there's just on and on and on so much more to the story. And I think those of us who have the power to do that have to tell that story.
What are the main ways that you think the mainstream media then has perhaps misrepresented the intention behind what you originally meant with the Me Too movement?
Well, you know, you see titles like so-and-so is the latest person to be Me Too'd, right? The media has turned it into a verb in many ways. Mm-hmm. And it's become a sport. People want to see who the next person is, who's going to be accused, and who the accuser is, and what does the accuser look like, and are they credible, and what's going to happen to the person? You know, will they lose their job? Are they contrite? It's just become spectator sport.
And it's quite salacious.
It is, and if you keep coming back to the salaciousness and not to the heart of it, there are systems in place that allow this to happen. If the media is not focusing on power and privilege, particularly the unchecked accumulation of power, right? We don't have enough conversation about that. We need to see long, in-depth stories about what it looks like. How did these individuals who committed these things, what allowed them to stay in power so long? Mm-hmm. What are they using their privilege for? You know, and how did they misuse their privilege? So I think that's some of the job that the mainstream media can do to sort of shift this narrative. This is more than just about the verdict coming forward being positive. This is about policy change, and this is about narrative change, and this is about cultural change. This is about things that are going to affect people's lives long term.
Mm-hmm. And you talk about power, and you talk about privilege and using it for service. Mm-hmm. What has the impact of President Donald Trump been on this movement and the cultural shift that you would want to see?
Not positive, if I could put that in a nutshell. You know, it is really hard. It's like, you know, swimming upstream. It's hard to have somebody who has the most powerful position in your country be a self-proclaimed sexual predator himself. So what kind of example are you setting for the country? You can't be a moral authority on this topic because of who you are. And it makes it difficult, being quite honest, but also not insurmountable, you know, because he is an elected official, which means that we have the power to vote him out.
Does it concern you when this week, for example, we've been seeing a spiraling of more claims about Michael Bloomberg, sexist and misogynist accusations about things that he's said? This is another person who looks like they might have a good shot at the nomination, potentially the White House. Again, how does that make you feel?
Well, you know, we started an initiative called Me Too Voter in the U.S. And the reason why we did that is so that survivors of sexual violence are seen as a constituent. And we can come out and use our voices, our power, to vote people in office who care about sexual violence. And again, I don't just want to know what your policy issue, or, you know, your policy platform is around it. Are you a moral authority on this? I want to know how you are going to contribute to the culture shift. And so if you are a person who perpetrates these things, anything close to rape culture, anything close to dealing with sexual violence, that's going to be deeply problematic because you then can't stand up and be an authority on this and say, we won't stand for this in this country. And that's what we need leadership to do, right? We won't have a culture shift just by changing laws and just by changing policy. Mm-hmm. We need somebody who is going to implement that from the top to the bottom.
And what would you say to critics that might argue that minor transgressions in someone's past, using bawdy language, saying mm-hmm. things in a flippant way about women or mm-hmm. about sexual violence, that isn't where the focus should be.
So this is something I try to explain all the time about sexual violence, that it happens on a spectrum, mm-hmm. right? There's nothing about the work we do that wants to put everybody in one box. Sexual violence happens on a spectrum. Accountability should happen on a spectrum. Mm-hmm. If you've used body language or been sexist or misogynist in the past, you should be accountable for that. It doesn't mean that you have the same outcome as a person who has actually been violent towards somebody, right? But it does mean that what you've said and what you've done contributes to rape culture. And rape culture creates the environment for violence to happen.
Mm-hmm. So how does it contribute to rape culture?
Because how does the language contribute to rape culture? Because imagine if you're in a place, if you work in a male-dominated field. If you are a woman working in a male-dominated field mm-hmm. Where you come to work every day and you're hearing people saying gross things about you, people reducing you to your body parts. One, it makes it very uncomfortable for you to work and be productive in that environment. But it also creates a permissive environment. So it only takes one person to think, well, if they can say that, then maybe I can touch her. Mm-hmm. Or maybe nobody will care if I behave this way. So it kind of lays the groundwork, right, to create mm-hmm. a culture, an environment where violence might be permissible, and that's not okay.
There's obviously been backlash to Me Too because it just was so massive. It is still huge. And people do have different interpretations of it. They don't necessarily know the intention with which it began.
Right.
I remember when the French actress, Catherine Deneuve, mm-hmm. and 100 other actresses, I think, wrote mm-hmm. this letter where they said that it was puritanical or puritanism and that men should be able to hit on women. What wires do you think have got crossed here?
Yeah, some of these wires, I think that men are not the only ones who can be misogynist and who can be sexist. We've all been raised to have certain views and certain ideas, and some of them aren't particularly feminist. But I also think that this came from mainstream media sort of just putting Me Too out, talking about these individual men and talking about it in ways that in big sweeping ways that didn't get into the nuances of it. If you are in a situation, a romantic situation with a woman, or you're dating a woman, you should be respectful of that woman, period. The part that I think that gets crossed all the time, though, is that this behavior is new, that there are some new rules that we've come up with since Me Too went viral. Mm. A lot of this behavior that we're talking about was always inappropriate. It was always wrong. It was always bad, and it made women feel uncomfortable. We just didn't feel like we had enough voice to speak up and say something about it, that we would be supported if we came forward. Mm. And I think that's the difference now. And I think that's why she came back and apologized when she realized that, you know, this is not what we're saying. It's not about disempowering women. Mm-hmm. It's about making sure that behavior that we know is inappropriate and can, again, lead to this permissive culture gets shifted.
So if you consider the lack of progress that's being made politically on this, and also the fact that I presume doing what you do, you must hear people's personal stories day in and day out. How do you not get demoralized when you're confronted with all this resistance and then also so many examples of terrible behavior and the worst of humanity?
Well, you know, I've been in this a long time. So I, from my own perspective, get to see the progress. I get to see the difference in where we were 10 or even 20 years ago and now. I remember a time when, you know, I just recently spoke at Oxford. I remember a time where I had to beg people to get into a room and get on an agenda so I could bring this topic to the forefront. And so there's definitely been progress, and that keeps me hopeful. You know, it depends on how you look at things. I hear the stories every day, but I also see the progress. I get the emails and letters from people who say, I want to be a part of this movement. I want to do something about this. We get that, a constant stream of that, and that makes me feel hopeful.
What tangible things would you like to see the movement achieve in the next 5 to 10 years?
Well, we want to start with this election. Right? Mm-hmm. We want to make sure that we have somebody in the White House that's representative of our goals and our values and who takes sexual violence seriously and can be an example of leadership and accountability. So that would be an immediate goal, that would be wonderful. But we're also looking at narrative shift and culture shift, meaning that we want to change what we're seeing in television and movies. We want to put more programming out that helps people understand the reality of sexual violence and not just what we see on serial television shows, right? We want to make sure that people understand that this is about survivors. It's about making sure they have the resources they need to heal, but it's also about taking action to end it. And so tangibly, we want to train people, particularly people who have survived sexual violence, to be leaders in the field, to go out and to be the voice and the face that we need and not have to just keep telling their story over and over again, but tell the story of what survival looks like and what it's necessary to, so more people can survive.
With your immediate priority being the election and getting a candidate in place that you think does take all of these issues seriously and is going to be an ally in this fight, who meets that criteria?
Well, we'll see. Right, we still have a big playing field, and really our mission is not to endorse a particular person, it's to make sure that all the people who are running hear what we have to say, and so that when they are going back into their, you know, to build their platforms out and to come back to speak to the American public, that they have this at the forefront.
Do you have any plans, and perhaps you already have, to expand your focus in the Me Too movement beyond where it's currently prevalent? So maybe to areas of the world where women's rights are fall woefully shy of even where they are in the US or in the UK or elsewhere, you know, like Afghanistan or Somalia, where, you know, there are forced marriages and honor killings and so much violence against women.
Yeah.
Do you have any plans to address that?
We are developing a global network right now. Mm. And part of the reason is because one of the things that, you know, Me Too did that I think is so amazing is that it created this way for people to build community with each other who would never be in conversation. Mm. And because of the power of the internet and social media, people started hashtags in countries all around the world. You know, we had Me Too India was huge last year and brought people into a conversation with us who we probably would have never been in conversation with. So we're excited to expand globally and to bring our message and our framework beyond the United States to other people who are ready to do this work on the ground in their countries.
And just finally, if there was one misconception that you'd want to clear up, what would it be? And secondly, if there's one thing that you think the movement is really getting right and you want to see people do more of, what would that be?
I think the biggest misconception is that we're anti-male and that this is a woman's movement, right? Mm-hmm. This is not a woman's movement, and there's nothing about us. We are pro-safety, not anti-male. Mm-hmm. And I would love for people to shift that understanding of what the movement is. And I think what we're getting right is making sure that people understand that this is about survivors. We have thousands of survivors who reach out to us really on a daily and weekly basis to say, thank you for doing this. And because you've done this, I now am able to do this other thing. Mm-hmm. And I think that we're doing really well. People are even changing their language, right? Less and less do you hear people saying victim, and they're using the word survivor. And we're just really shifting the focus back to where it should be. Mm-hmm.